river will run dry. Stop, come on.
sing it over your lives, sing it over your families.
Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No way.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
You have your way.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No.
Who can stop the Lord?
Come on, put your hands together, lift your voice.
Before we continue to worship, why don't you turn around, find somebody you don't know, and welcome them today. This morning to worship, we're going to sing a song that we learned last week called Who You Say I Am. Let's sing out, Who Am I?
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me on His love for me. On His love. Chosen.
That's right. Yes, I am. You may be seated. My name is Manny, one of your pastors here, and it is Baptism Sunday, one of my favorite weekends here. Yes. We're so excited. Speaking of child of God, we have Miss Lily right here. She's making a decision to get baptized today. I had a chance to chat with her a little bit. Yes. What's up with that? Yes. Simply put, I kind of asked some homework for her, and you know, why do you want to get baptized? What does it mean to you? And simply stated, God lives inside my heart. This is what we do, right? So let's celebrate that. Thank you, parents, for leading the way as well. Lily, I have a question for you. Have you asked Jesus inside your heart as Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Let's celebrate that already. Miss Lily. Well, Miss Lily, because of that, it truly is our honor to baptize you today. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Man, that's so exciting. Well, Journey, I have with me Thane. Everybody say hi, Thane. All right. Get this. Are we good? Well, Thane has quite a journey. He shared with me, this is a special, special day for you, right, Thane? Back in the day, his mom taught him about God, but he went on his own, started to live your own way, didn't you? And kind of walked away from God a little bit, but 2 years ago, you became sober, and he's been sober for 2 years. Come on, Journey. Yeah. You hear that? These are people that are for you, man, just like God is for you, just like we sang. They're for you. Thane talked about walking into Journey, and he said it just felt like home. It just felt like I'm in where I'm supposed to be. And we know that the enemy would want to come against you, but the Bible tells us that greater is he that it lives in you than he that is in this world. So today's a big day for you, and we're proud of you. You've asked Jesus into your heart, right, Thane? Well, it's my honor now to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Celebrate my friend Thane over there. We got Cody right here. Say hi, Cody. Man, we're so excited. Now, he has a boot right now, but that doesn't matter, right? Because when it's time, it's time. Got to kind of talk to Cody a little bit as well, and I love kind of just hearing mom just kind of sharing his heart and says, I want to do this. And she's like, as a parent, make sure you know what it is. Explain, yes, I get it. I understand. This is something I want to do to kind of just paint this picture for all that God lives inside of me. And then he did something amazing. He turned around and helped his sister understand what this was and walked her through that step. So it's a great opportunity, Cody, as just leading strong, that today is the day that you'll never forget. So Cody, I have a question for you. Have you asked Jesus inside your heart as Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Yes. Let's celebrate Cody right there for that. Hold your nose. Well, because of that, Cody, it is our honor to baptize you today. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Oh, that's awesome. I have my friend Joshua Queller here with me, and man, Joshua has an incredible story. First of all, I want to thank you on behalf of Journey Church for serving our country and the military. Come on, give it up for him. Yeah, that's awesome. We know it hasn't been an easy road for you either, but man, God gets the glory. A couple weeks before Easter, you talked to me about it was just a rough season, man, and you felt like the enemy didn't want you to come, but Easter, you came anyway. You persevered, you pushed through it, and I've been dealing with some PTSD and all of that, but when you gave your life to Jesus, you told me that that's minimal now, that Jesus has cleaned you on the inside, that he's doing a work in you, and you want the world to know that you serve Jesus, right? Yeah, man, come on. Well, it's my honor and my privilege to baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yeah.
Come on, sing with us. Oh, it's free. I'm a child. our hands together and surrender. Oh, my life surrender, my heart abandoned for more of you. My soul devotion.
All that Christ could do for you, man. I'm telling you right now, some of you in here saying, I need to get baptized. I need to have that in my life. I want to do that. Here's the simplest way to do it. Take this card that you may have just sat on, right? Fill this out, and on the very back of it, just check the box that talks about baptism, and we will get you set up for our next baptism in May. But for the rest of us, man, we are so glad that you're here for week two of our series, Tempted. Those of you watching online, we are so glad you're here with us as well. We have a lot coming up here at Journey Church, but there is a great chance right now that there are some of you in here for the very first time, and we just want to welcome you to Journey Church. My name's Chad. I'm one of the pastors here, and we would love the chance to get to know you before you leave here today. One of the best ways for that to happen is by simply taking out this card that I was just talking about that was on your seat. If you could do me a favor, take one of the pens from the seat in front of you, then afterwards, after service, steal that pen, take it with you. But right now, what I would love for you to do is just fill this card out. And then at the very end of our service, all you need to do is place it in one of our red giving bins that are placed throughout our lobby before you leave here. We are so glad that you're here. And then after you're done filling that out, you can just turn that card over, because like I said, we do have quite a bit coming up here at Journey. And one of those things happens on Mother's Day. And for those of you maybe with little kids and you're interested in child dedication, man, we want to encourage you to sign up on the connection card. This is when you, your family are saying, hey, look, we are going to commit to raise our children in the love and admonition of Christ. You can just check that box and our kids team will contact you this week. Make sure that you have everything you need for that. And then another thing we have coming up that starts on the 7th of May is something that impacts our family directly, which is Financial Peace University. Guys, this 9-week course led by a guy named Dave Ramsey has the chance to change your financial future. Man, I'm telling you, for my wife and I, it has helped us get out of $19,000 worth of debt, and we are almost there becoming financially free. We're so excited about it, and I know this is what Financial Peace says. 76% of people live paycheck to paycheck and have about $60,000 to $80,000 worth of debt on their head. But Financial Peace University graduates, the average, will save, right, $1,000 in an emergency fund within the first 90 days, will have at least $2,300 in savings, and pay off about $5,300 worth of debt without adding any income to your family. You might be saying, Chad, well, okay, so there's probably a cost to that. Well, there is a cost to the class, But the truth of the matter is, guys, look, if you're struggling financially and you're trying to figure out this financial thing, man, you can't afford not to go to Financial Peace University. And you can sign up in the lobby right after service, out to the left. Our team will be out there to get you registered. It's coming up. Be a part of it. And in the process, you're going to build some incredible community through Financial Peace University. And there are some of you in here, man, you get financial freedom and you're able to do things in your with your finances that a lot can't do right now. Maybe one of those things that you could possibly do is maybe sponsor someone to go on our upcoming Mexico trip, or even go on that Mexico trip yourself. And we do have a Mexico trip coming up, and we have an informational meeting about that trip tonight at 5:30 over in the venue right across the parking lot. So if you're interested in being a part of that Mexico trip, we're going to be building houses, we're going to be investing into children in orphanages, we're going to have an incredible experience. But the truth is, that trip will change and transform your life, and it has done with so many. But if you want to go, be at that informational meeting today at 5:30. And I just want to let you guys know, we're talking about building homes and all of that over in Mexico. But if you give here financially, whether you give online, texting, or whether you give through the envelopes in front of you, you need to know that you are purchasing those homes, the materials, the cost, the paint, the furnishings, everything that happens over there. I want to say thank you for your investment into all that God is doing around the world. And I know that God is going to be doing a lot of stuff in here today. Take a look at this video.
Director, and we are looking forward to seeing you tonight, April 15th at 5:30 at our Lake Worth campus in our new building, The Venue. For more information, head to the lobby and see you there.
Temptation, an inescapable piece of the human condition. Anger. Pride, money, lust, addictions, emotions. Temptation presents us with different masks throughout our lives, attempting to fill voids in our hearts. We don't have to lose to these battles. We don't have to feel the pangs of sin. Because you have the ability to win the battle of temptation and learn how to live a life free from regrets.
Well, welcome everybody. It's, it's always so good to be here, and I am so excited about today and everyone in Boynton, our Boynton campus. I'm so glad you're joining us as well as everyone watching church online. It was great just chatting with you. And we are in a series on how to win the battle of temptation. Because no matter who you are or what you believe, every one of us understand in this life and in this world that we face urges and struggles to do the right thing at times. And there are things in our lives that call us and draw us to lead us off the course that God has for us, or the course that we want to be at our lives. So the series has been all about helping equip each of us to win the battles of temptation and to learn to live life without the pain and without the regrets that bad decisions and choices often make. And so today what I want to do is I want to talk a little bit about how environments that we place ourselves in, circumstances, the situations that we place ourselves in, how it affects our battle in temptation of whether we lose or, once again, whether we win. Now, in order to take a look and understand about environments and the impact they have on our life, I'm going to call out a friend of mine to come help illustrate something about how powerful and impactful the environments we allow ourselves and our loved ones to be in actually is. So Rocket, come on out, buddy. Come on, Rocket. Come on. Come on. Come on. Yeah, good boy. Good boy. Good boy. Okay. So what I want to do is we're going to look at how he handles a certain temptation. Now, I don't know about you. Rocket, come here. Come here. Come here. Sit right here. Sit, buddy. Sit. Okay, sit. That's my boy. Okay. Now, I don't know about you, but when it comes to temptation, there is one thing that tempts Rocket. No. There's one thing that tempts my dog more than anything else in the world, and it is steak. So this morning, I grilled over a smoke grill, really awesome grill. I grilled this steak, this ribeye steak with fat and juice. It's amazing, and you had to smell it and aroma with it. And I want us to understand something about environments and the environments we place her in and the impact that it has on our temptation. You see, 5 minutes ago, this little guy was sitting in my office, and you know what he was doing? Sleeping. He was not tempted at all to disobey his dad. Not at all. He wasn't struggling and battling. But here's what I want us to see something, right? When I placed him in an environment, the proximity to something that tempts him and draws him, guess what's happening in his body right now? He is struggling. Everything in him is looking at this. And every single thing in this dog, you know what he wants? All he wants is steak. All he can think about is steak. Here's why. Because it's within his senses. See, there's something about us that when we find ourselves in proximity to something that tempts us, it awakens desires. 5 minutes ago, he's not thinking about it. Now that's all he can think about, right? Not only does it awaken his desires. Listen, I removed any barrier from him. You see, that steak was in the refrigerator all night long, but there was a barrier between him and the steak, and so that temptation was no longer something that was such a struggle. But when we remove the barriers or obstacles to what tempts us, and we place ourselves in proximity to what tempts us, what happens? It increases the temptation, doesn't it? It makes obedience something so difficult for us to do when we're in these environments, because the environments we're in affects us. Now, here's why I say this. Because if I leave him in this environment, this proximity, and I leave him with no obstacles, and I just leave him like this, eventually what's going to happen is this. He's going to fail, isn't he? He's going to fail. And maybe what's going to happen in his life is he's going to think, Dad's not watching, Dad doesn't care, no big deal, steak's more important than anything else. I don't know what it is. But at some point, when he put ourselves in that environment over and over again, he won't even look at it. Do you see that? He's smart. So I'll make this easier on myself. I don't want to see it. He just looks away. All right? Now, the most embarrassing part of this is he's doing better than most of us when it comes to temptation, right? But here's what I want to see. Listen. The environments we place ourselves in often determine whether we lose or whether we win when it comes to the battle of temptation. The environments that we place ourselves in, whether it's who we're with, the people that we're with, the boundaries you don't keep in our life, how close we get to things that can harm, often determine whether we win or whether we lose. And there's a lot of people in our lives, so we'll see, that live just like this. We allow certain things that can cause so much harm in our kids, in our life, in our marriage, in our own souls, and we bring it just close enough to us. We remove obstacles, we leave it right there, and we wonder why so often in life we fail. So today what we're going to look at is we're going to look at environments and the impact they have in our temptations, and we're going to learn how to look at our environments and help change and alter the environments that we and our loved ones are in to help us do better in winning the battle of temptation. Let's give Rocket a big hand. Should we let him eat it? Get it. Good boy. All right. You did so good. Oh, did he drop it? Come on. Let's go. Here we go. There we go. Thank you very much. All right. Rocket, go, buddy. You were doing so good. I didn't know how it would go. He actually did really good. It was pretty impressive when it comes to that. So my kids might not do so well. But as I say, here's what I want to see. You see, when it comes to proximity, when it comes to removing barriers, what you're going to discover is this is exactly what Adam and Eve did in their own life. is that when you look at their failure and you look at what takes place, one of the things I want you to notice is, I want you to notice how close they are and how little barriers there are in the path to them and the one thing that can destroy their life. And I want you to think about this for a moment. God has given Adam and Eve run of the whole garden. They have it all. Like, they can enjoy everything. But I want you to notice, before they failed, where is it when it comes to proximity, and where is it when it comes to the barriers they are from there and the one bit thing that could destroy their life? Notice what happens right here. When the woman, and what's that word right there? Saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing the eye and also desire of gaining wisdom, she took some and she ate it. Now, to see something, what does that mean? There's proximity. There's proximity. There's a whole garden, and yet she's choosing to be at a place, I want us to see this, so close to what she desires that it increases the desire, right? Because it's like you've been in a movie theater, you smell popcorn, makes you want it. And now she's right there. She's at arm length, no barrier, and there she is to the one thing that can mess her life up. And then she also gave it to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Poor guy. Now here's what I see. If we're going to use wisdom to win this battle of temptation, right? If we're going to do this, if we understand that environments often determine whether we lose or whether we win when it comes to the battle of temptation, okay, wouldn't it make more sense if you're Adam and you're Eve to develop a way to not put yourself in that environment? Like, look at hindsight. If there's only one thing that can wreck your life, right? Because all of us have different things we're tempted to, right? If there's one thing that could, you know, can mess your life up, wouldn't it make sense to go, okay, Adam, Eve, here, let's do this. Let's get thorn bushes. Let's dig them up, and let's put thorn bushes all around this tree. Why? Because if, for whatever reason, one day we have this urge or desire, I want to make it really, really hard to follow my urges and desires and feelings and wreck my life and wreck our marriage. So let's build obstacles between us and the thing that tempts us and can destroy us. Or why not get accountability, boundaries? Why not predetermine and go, okay, hey, guys, this is the one thing we can mess our lives with. Let's be wise and let's make a rule together. We won't get within 100 yards of this tree. I don't even want to see it. Why live like that? Why start to sell? Why create and awaken desires in our lives and our heart? Let's not do that. So let's make a covenant together, and here's the boundaries we're going to place. We're going to draw a line, dig a ditch, whatever, 100 yards around it, and we're never going to go there, because why in the world we want to put ourselves in the environment that can fail? But they don't do any of it, do they? And instead, what does she do? There's no barriers. She can reach out and grab it. There's no accountability. They're together and no one's saying a word, right? And then they put themselves right in the proximity so the desire is awakened, and then they fail. And what you will discover in almost every failure of your life, when you actually failed, you were usually one step away from failure when you did. That long before the failure, you took a lot of steps, got closer and closer and closer to the line. And so when that weakness came, it was so easy to reach out and do, say, grab, act, whatever you want to say in these manners, in these ways. Now, here's why I say this. Before we get into how to do this, what I really want to answer is the question of, why do you think they didn't create the boundaries? Like, if there's one thing that can mess their life up, why in the world would they not have a conversation? Why didn't they? And maybe better yet, why don't we? Why do so many of us live our lives in our relationships and our marriages and our souls and things? Why do you look at so many people that make so many bad mistakes and they train wreck their life? Why, as human beings, do we not create better boundaries in our lives to help protect people and our loved ones from failure? And here's the first reason. I think there's three main. Here's the first one. One is this: we're embarrassed to say we need it. Right? Because to admit that we're weak, right? To admit that we might fail means that we're weak. And we think to ourselves, what kind of man are you that could do the wrong thing and mess your family? What kind of woman are you that you need a boundary? Why don't you just do the right thing? How pathetic are you? Why? So we have shame and guilt that comes in. So we never acknowledge that we need help and they're weak. And so we don't. And as a result, we often fail. And then we experience even greater shame and guilt. Here's a second reason. For some of us, you haven't failed yet in this arena. And so your thought process, like Eve, right? I've walked by the tree 100 times. I've never failed. I've never been weak. I'm a strong person. And because I've never failed in the past, I'm a good person. I don't really need to put a safeguard in my life because I'm going to be fine. I'm not going to fail. And here's the third reason, is because we think we're good people. And what we assume is that good people always do good things and that bad people do bad things. And because I'm not a bad person, I'm a good person, I'm not going to do a bad thing. So I don't need a boundary in my life. And I think this is exactly where Eve is. Eve is finding herself with Adam going, hey, you know what? I'm not going to say I need help here. And not only that, I've walked by this tree 100 times. Both of us have. We've never failed. We're strong. We're both good people. We don't even know what sin is, right? Good people do good things. So we can be right next to the tree. and we won't partake. We don't need any boundaries, any accountability, anything at all. We can live right next to it, and I'll always have the power, and I'll always have the strength, and I will never fail. And here's what I want us to see about this, right? That part of the reason Eve failed was the overconfidence that she had that she can get close enough to this and not fail. You could say it like this. The people that don't believe they can fail are often in the most danger to fail. The people that believe that, you know what, I'm good enough and I'm a good person and good people don't do bad things, right? And I love God and I love Jesus. You know, Jesus is awesome because I love Jesus and I'm a good man. I would never hurt the one I love. I would never hurt the family that I love. I would never do something that I'd be ashamed and guilt of, right? And so what happens in our lives is because we feel we're so good, because we believe we could never do it, we oftentimes don't put boundaries, accountability, and safeguards in our lives. And then we wonder when we see good men fail. Good women fail. Good people make good, bad decisions. Your good student do something that you know and they regret and feel bad doing. In fact, this is exactly what we see in the life of Peter. See, Peter the apostle was a good man. He was an amazing man. And he loved Jesus with all of his heart, all of his soul, and his mind. He would literally give his life for Jesus, and one day he actually would. And because of this, one day, Jesus comes up to Peter and goes, hey, Peter, guess what? I want to warn you something. I know you're a good man. I know you love me, but you're going to do something to betray the man, the person you love, which is me. You're going to do a bad thing, Peter. You got to get ready. You are going to fail. And I want you to see the overconfidence, same as Eve, that you see Peter portray in his life. And here we go. Listen to what Peter says. Even if all fail away, Peter said, on account of you, I never will. Jesus, you don't understand. I'm a good man, and good men don't do bad things. Jesus, you don't understand. Like, I know that other people might let you down, but I love you so much, I will never let you down. You are, I mean, you don't know who I am. Like, you don't worry about me. I don't need boundaries in my life because I am a good individual. Listen to what Jesus says as a response to this. Because once again, I believe he's saying it not just to Peter, he's saying it to us. I tell you the truth, Jesus said, Mr. Overconfident. This very night, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. You will betray the person you love the most in this world. But Peter declared, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the other disciples said the same thing. Jesus, I know that you are the Son of God and you know a lot of things, but you are wrong in this one thing. You don't realize, Jesus, I'm a good man, and good men don't do bad things. Only bad men do. You don't understand how much I love you. I will die for you, Jesus. You don't understand. I love you too much to fail you. Listen, not only that, how long have I been faithful? I've never once failed you in all of the years. What makes you not trust me now? How could you not trust me? Don't you know my love? I'm a good person. Listen to this. I don't care how problems there are. I am so strong. You name me the rock, Jesus. Remember, I walked on water with you. Like, you don't understand. And I know that other people might fail you, but I will never fail you. And listen to what Jesus says, because I think in many ways, this is what we often say to our own selves. Hey, you know what? My husband's a good man. He would never. My wife's an amazing person. She would never. My kid's got a good head on her shoulders. I don't care what environment, she'll always make the right decision, right? Like, sometimes we do the same thing that Peter does. And notice what Jesus says. Watch and pray. Be careful so that you will not fail in a temptation. For the spirit is willing, and I love this, but the body is weak. You got to be careful, Peter. You're overconfident. And you need to put boundaries in your life. Like, you need to watch and pray. Get accountability. You have 12 guys around you that all love me, right? You're good examples. Let's get together. Don't be alone, right? And I want you to pray. I want you to seek strength. I want you to get ready. Because let me tell you something. You are going to fail. You are going to fail. So you need to prepare. And what is Peter's heart? No, I don't need to. And I love what Jesus is saying here. Peter, listen, you don't realize something. Good men do bad things. Peter, you understand something. People do things that they regret and hurt people they love every day. Peter, you don't realize something. I don't care how strong you think you are. You don't realize how weak a strong man can be. You need to guard yourself, protect yourself, prepare, put the boundaries, put the obstacles, get ready because you are capable of failing even though you are a good man. What does Peter do? He falls asleep. Because the one thing that he knows is that Jesus is wrong. And the one thing that he knows is how much he loves Jesus and what an amazing man that he is. and he does not need to worry about it. And so him and all of the disciples would fall asleep because they don't need the boundaries. Good men don't do bad things. Strong men aren't weak. And I don't care what environments I am strong enough to withstand it, and I will give my life for you. You know why Peter was thinking this? Let me tell you why. Because every single thing that Peter thought was 100% truth. In fact, we know it's truth because moments later, not days later, moments later, after he speaks this, there are some soldiers that come forth and they come to take Jesus. And what does Peter do? And Peter takes out his sword and by himself, he charges all of these armed guards to defend Jesus. And he takes out the sword and he takes off the ear of one of these armed guards, willing to go for his death because that's how much he loved Jesus. And I can imagine him sitting there in a moment with a sword in one hand, covered in blood, holding this guy's ear, going to Jesus, listen, I told you so. Like, I get your son of God and everything and do all these miracles, but this is one time you're wrong. It was now because I love you enough and I didn't fail. Look at the environment I was in. I was strong enough. Jesus, you missed this one. I was willing to die for you. But here's what Peter didn't take into account. Is in that moment he was strong. And he loved Jesus enough, and he could handle that temptation, the one of the soldiers, and he passed. But what Peter didn't realize is that something would profoundly change in the environment that he lived in. And what would profoundly change is that Jesus that he loved would do something that he did not understand. You ever been in a relationship with someone that did something to hurt you? That was Peter. He loved Jesus, but all of a sudden, Jesus goes, I'm not going to fight. I'm not going to fight. Wait. Listen, Jesus, if you're really God, you're going to let evil win? Like, Jesus, wait. You're going to rebuke me for trying to protect you? Like, I don't understand. Like, how could you do that? Why aren't you fighting back? All the other disciples have left. Jesus, I don't understand. Why would you let evil win? If you're really that strong, I mean, you did all these miracles, God. Like, I thought this kingdom we were going to build together, and now you're just being taken off in chains, and you're doing nothing, and then you're rebuking me. And now Peter finds himself in this moment where his trust in God began to be severed. His love, if you will, for Jesus began to be shaken for a season because he doesn't understand what's happening in his life. And all of a sudden, this man that was so strong, he was willing to die for Jesus. In a matter of a minute, that strong man became weak. And then in that moment of weakness, the circumstance changed. And instead of being surrounded by 12 men that loved Jesus, a good crowd, he started going into a crowd of people that hated Jesus, that despised him. And all of the fear and all of the anxiety that this once strong man, this good man Peter, who's willing to give his life for Jesus, found himself in a vulnerable position in an environmental change. And what does he do? He denies Jesus. Not once, not twice, but three times. In fact, notice as we look at the third failure in his life. About an hour later, another asserted. After two, he's already failed twice. Certainly this fellow, Peter, was with him, Jesus, for he is Galilean. And Peter replied, man, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know Jesus. What are you, Jesus who? Like, can you be more specific? Like, Jesus, there's a lot of Jesus out there. I'm not really sure. Like, I don't know that Jesus. I want nothing to do with that Jesus. He called down curses about them and over Jesus publicly in front of these people. And just as he was speaking, one of the most chilling verses in the scripture, the rooster crowed, and Jesus, the Lord, turned and looked straight at Peter. The Peter that moments before was willing to give his life for Jesus in front of Jesus betrayed the person he loved the most. Peter, the one that was willing to give his life for Jesus, betrayed him. And we're told in that moment of failure when the rooster crowed, he was reminded of what Jesus said and he ran off and he wept with guilt and shame and failure. And as he wept because he couldn't believe what he had done, he ran away from ministry. He ran away from his calling for a season. He went back to catch fish because there's no way God could use something like me. He couldn't believe what he had done because a good man did a bad thing. And a strong man became weak. And when an environment changed in his weakness, Peter failed because he didn't put the safeguards in his life. Because when Jesus told him, this is a possibility for your life, he didn't believe he could fail. And the people that believe that they can't fail are often in the most danger to fail because we do the same thing that Peter did in his life. I can never do it, so I'm not going to worry about it. So here's what I want to do for the rest of the day. If Peter, who walked on water, if Peter, who fed thousands and healed people and brought people from the dead, could fail, how much more can we? How much more can our middle school kid? How much more can our marriage? How much more can you, in whatever stage of life, in the right environment, in the wrong circumstances, and maybe you're strong 99% of the time, in the right perfect moment, how often in our lives can we and do we have the capability to fail? And if we do, here's what I want to challenge you to do. Then why not do what Adam and Eve didn't, what Peter didn't do, two people that failed? Why not create safeguards around our lives? And so what I want to end today with is three things that you can do. Three things that you can do in your lives and in our marriages and with our families and in our own selves to protect us from those moments of weakness. And I want us to understand why we do this, and this is this. Wisdom isn't weakness. In other words, understanding that you can fail and you have struggles, and then in a moment you might be strong, but in one moment weak, and using your wisdom to create safeguards in your life, that's not being weak, that's being wise. Creating safeguards within your family is not being weak or being like judgmental towards them or assuming the worst of them, not believing them. No, it's being loving and trying to protect them from failure. And so let's look at three things that I think that we can do in our lives to help us not have the guilt, not have the shame, not have some of the scars that so many people have in our lives. And the first one is this. Lock the doors that you can lock. Do you realize in some temptations in this world, there's nothing you can do, right? They're going to be there. There's nothing you can do. You can't go to an island, right? You're going to face temptation. But there are some things in this world. Do you know you can make it really hard to sin in certain ways in your life? You can create boundaries in your life and lock doors that are very difficult to open. Perfect example. I'd say it's around 15 years ago, my wife used to love sweets. She still loves sweets today, but she eats so healthy now and does such an amazing job and much better than I do in that. But 15 years ago, she wasn't as strong. And one of the things that she loved was sweets, chocolate, absolutely loved it. And so the way in our old house where we used to have it, we took the garage, we made it to like a theater, we painted the wall, and we put this popcorn maker in to make popcorn. And then I had this glass refrigerator about this big. And the glass refrigerator was filled top to bottom with all the sweets you can imagine. It was literally, the kids called it the candy store, right? It was the candy store. And so it was great. We watch movies in the house. You just open up. You just get whatever you want. And you know, all the candy you can imagine. Everybody, the kids, the neighborhood kids, everybody wanted to come to the candy store. We all watch movies. Had a lot of fun. Now, when it comes to sweets, listen to me. They're not the biggest temptation for me. Mine, Coke Slurpees, okay? It's hard for me to go buy 7-Eleven. Coke Slurpees, that's hard. But for chocolate, I can take a bite. 3 days later, take another bite. I'm okay. My wife, that was a different story 15 years ago. And so I remember from time to time, I would come home, and I would see my wife, and she'd be sitting around, and then around her would be all of the wrappings of the chocolate candy that she had raided the candy store. And one of the things that I learned in marriage was, and I discovered this later on, is that somehow this was my fault. Hey, she's sitting right there, right? So she's right there. So admit this, right? It's my fault. Like, and she would ask the question very lovingly, why did you put it in the house? Like, why would you have this here when you know that I like it, you know? Why would you do this, you know? And so being the loving, amazing, supporting husband, I decided that I would come up with a perfect solution that would allow candy to be in the house for me and my boys' enjoyment, right? And also no longer cause her to fail in this one area of temptation in her life. And so the brilliant idea I had, and you might not agree, we'll see where you guys think on this, but here's this brilliant idea. I got a key and locked the refrigerator. Right? It was brilliant, see? It's like now she can't fall. She could have a moment of weakness. She could want the chocolate, but she can't get through a glass door. And so remember, this isn't our main refrigerator, so she can get food. This is just candy refrigerator, okay? And so one day, true story, I'm sitting in the backyard. I remember this like yesterday, even though it was like 15 years ago. And she comes into the backyard and looks at me, and all she said is, "Where's the key?" I didn't tell her that I was going to do this and help her out by locking the refrigerator. And she says, "Where's the key? Where's the key?" And I just say, "Honey, I can't. I'm not going to give you the key, right?" Because I found myself a dilemma. If I give her the key, then she'll eat the candy and it's my fault. If I don't give her the key, then she's mad at me for having the refrigerator. It's my fault. Either way, I was losing. I was just trying to figure out the best way to lose this battle. And because in this refrigerator, just for the record, lights were shining down it and all the candy was illuminated and she couldn't get to it. And true story, she tackled me in the backyard to try to get the key out for me. She didn't get the key. And I slept on the couch for a month. But I'm kidding. Here's why I say this, and all joking aside. There are some temptations in our lives that we can actually help people in by locking doors and not making it possible to open. Like if pornography, which is a huge temptation, right? You look at the statistics, I think it's somewhere around 70% on a regular basis of men in America, even Christians, look at pornography. You know, we know that the effects of it, right? You know that it chemically rewires a brain, especially the worst is the young boys, they see those sort of things, and what it does, it literally controls and teaches them to objectify women. It teaches them unhealthy things. It literally, it's like it reduces the chemicals like a cocaine would. It produces an addiction, an unhealthy view of sexuality and all of these things. And there's just incredible studies out there that show you it is not harmless, right? It is absolutely destructive. And do you know that we can't prevent our kids ever from seeing anything, but we can actually lock a lot of doors? Like, do you know that every phone you go on your iPhone, I have it on mine, you can have someone give you a code that you don't have and you lock out and you can lock out a dog on it? You know you can do that? Like, in other words, see, you can lock certain doors. Yes, they can find it other ways, but how much harder is it going to be when you have to go out of the house? In other words, let's take something and let's lock the doors that we can lock to make it easier. So in that moment of weakness, it's not one step away. Let's at least create barriers and obstacles from them fulfilling certain things and desires in their lives. And yet 70%, we're told, of families leave their kids and they have no lock. The door's unlocked. They do nothing. Every cable box, every direct TV box. In other words, there are things that we can do. There are some doors that we can lock. So lock the doors that we can lock. Think of it like this. Social media. Do you know that 1 in 5 affairs begins on social media? So here's the question. Why not give your wife or your husband access to your social media account? Like, why not make it easier to stay faithful instead of harder? Why not? In fact, my wife, she doesn't do social media. She does on Facebook, but she has my account on her phone. So she could know every message, every thought, every question, everything posted. All of these things is there. You know what that does? It's great. You know why? It just makes it harder to fail. Because if you create the right boundaries in your life and you lock certain doors, even in a moment of weakness, because there's no relationship kindled, because there's nothing there, it's harder to take that step because there are boundaries put in place. Why? Is it because I'm not trustworthy? Maybe. Now I am, but maybe not. Like, why take a chance? Why I struggle with this? There was just literally a famous pastor this year, this just 2 days ago, 42 years of ministry, to step down from things similar to this. So here's my question. And the first thing he said was, man, I should have created better boundaries. I should have never been alone with these girls. I should have done things differently. And as a result, 42 years of following Jesus and some mistakes probably were made. We don't even know he's denying some. Who knows? But he's literally having to resign because why? He didn't lock doors that could be locked. And he looks at everyone going, man, I wish I would have done these things different. Now, listen to me. For those of you that are kids in here and parents, I get this is tough, right? Because if you've ever had a child, let me just give you some advice, parents right here, and kids, don't get mad at me for this, right? When your kid comes up and goes, you want my Instagram password? You want access to Snapchat? Like I don't understand. You want to do that? No way. What, Mom, you don't trust me? Here's the answer. No. No. Here's why. Because you were in middle school, high school once, right? Did you always make the right decision? Absolutely not. Do you have regrets? Absolutely. And here's the greatest response when your middle school kid, high school kid comes up to you and goes, Mom and Dad, I can't believe this. You're trolling me. You're finding my Facebook page. Whatever. You don't trust me. Here's what I would ask. Just simple questions. Just say his name is Johnny. Johnny, have you ever walked on water like Peter? Johnny, listen, have you fed thousands of people from a few loaves of bread? Johnny, have you touched people and in your result healed them and brought them back from dead? Johnny, have you ever been willing to give your life for Jesus? Okay, no, to answer to all those questions, great. Well, guess what? Peter did all those things right, and he still failed. And if he needed boundaries, how much more do you, and how much more do me, and how much more do all of us wanting to protect yourself? Here's what I'm saying. It isn't about being some militaristic background. It isn't about trying to control everything. You know what it is? It's trying to protect them. Because wisdom isn't weakness. So don't get mad at your mom and don't get mad at your dad. I do the same thing. Listen, I have the same accountability in my life. You know why? Because I don't want to have those regrets. I don't want to look back and lose my family or ministry or my soul because of decisions that were made in my life. And even in moments of weakness, even though I believe I'm strong enough most of the time, I don't even want to give myself an opportunity to fail. Lock the doors that you can lock. You can't stop everything. But you can stop a lot of things. Here's the second thing I want you to do. Predetermine your boundaries. Predetermine your boundaries. Don't wait to the party to decide how many drinks you're going to have. Right? Don't wait to, in the heat of the moment with your boyfriend and your girlfriend, you want to honor God physically with your body. Don't wait till you get there and go, okay, now let's make the decision. Right? That's not the best time to make decisions, trust me. You don't want to make decisions right then, right? So what you got to do is you predetermine, hey, before I get to the party, before I do these things, what I want to do is I want to create distance and boundaries from the things that could cause me to fail. And so here's my boyfriend, my girlfriend. We both love Jesus. We want to make these right decisions. So here's what the line is, and we're going to make sure we're going to stay in this line. And maybe that line is going to be, my parents did this to me. Hey, when you can't be alone in the house and we're not there. Why? Because you don't trust me? Exactly. Exactly, but maybe it wasn't me. Well, they didn't trust her or trust him or whatever it might be in your situation. See, the point is, it's why not predetermine. Here's the rule. You're not allowed to be in a house alone with your boyfriend or your girlfriend. Or maybe for you, it's, hey, we're not going to spend the night together because, man, that just puts it in the worst situation. It makes it so difficult to say and be pure. Hey, we're not going to be together on vacation in certain ways. What are we doing? We're predetermining boundaries. Our president, our vice president did this. It's called the Billy Graham rule. And where it comes from is many, many years ago, Billy Graham walked back to his hotel room after this crusade. He was teaching people. As he opened the door, somehow a woman had got into his room, was laying in his bed. And he looked and turned around and walked off. And you know what he realized? He was strong enough to say no tonight. But what if one day him and Ruth, his wife, got into a fight? What if one day he's coming off a dry season like Peter with God? What if in a moment of weakness, there he was by himself traveling all over the world in all of these hotel rooms. Instead, from that point forward, he goes, I'm never going to travel alone. Now, I know for some of you can't do that, but that was what he could do. What am I going to do? I'm going to predetermine boundaries. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm always going to travel with someone. I'm never going to travel alone because then I'll never have the opportunity away from everyone where I think I'm in private, right, to make a mistake that could derail my life and things that I love the most. Because if Peter could fail, then so could Billy Graham. And our vice president did that. He's made certain boundaries. Here's what I'm going to do. Listen, I want to make sure that I don't make a mistake. So I'm not going to do certain things with women or go to meet in private meetings, go in cars. I'm going to just be careful to make sure these things never happen. Now, if our president would have done some of those things, he'd have a lot less problems in his life. This is why, listen, at the church, we've created some boundaries that are predetermined. Here's some of them. If you're a married man, you're not allowed to be alone in a car with an unmarried woman. Same thing. If you're a married woman, you're not allowed to be in a car. Why? Because we don't trust. Well, listen, here's my question. Why create opportunities that people could fail? We don't let people of the opposite sex counsel each other in a private setting. We don't. Why? Because all of a sudden, somebody comes in, my marriage is so bad. My husband isn't there. He doesn't do this. And oh, here's the way. Oh, you're such a godly man. You're such a good man. Oh, this is what he should be. And all of a sudden, a moment of weakness, two people can find this relationship. Why? Because you've opened this door. You haven't made these boundaries. And all it takes is a moment of weakness. And I know multiple pastors, by the way, that have failed from counseling the opposite sex and end up having an affair with them. And so you know what we said? Why not remove those boundaries? Like, why not put the, why make us like rocket, like, why make this more difficult than it is? In the same way, in my office, like I have my office, old office is right over here in this room, and there's a huge glass. And so if I ever met with someone, especially a girl, everybody could see. It was like wide open. There was complete transparency. I just moved about a week or so ago to this new office, and one of the first things I told Sean, our executive director, is, hey, there's no glass in this window. I want a new door with glass in it. Why? Well, because I don't trust ourselves. Nothing to do with that. Why create an opportunity? Like, why ever in a moment of weakness give ourselves an opportunity? So let's create safeguards. Why? Because I would rather admit that I am weak and not fail than assume that I'm strong and then fail. And so some of us in our lives, we got to do is we got to predetermine boundaries. We got to have uncomfortable conversations so that we don't fail. And last but not least, here's a third one. Strengthen your weakness. You see, you can't boundary everything and you can't lock every door, right? There are just certain things in your life that there's, no matter what you do, you can still have access to them and you struggle with them. And so here's what I challenge you to do. You know your area of weakness. Why not find ways to strengthen it? What is it that constantly tempts you as a struggle? Is it fear? Is it anxiety? Is it you have a hard time being fully present? You can't sleep. You're thinking, your mind rolls and rolls over all the worst case scenarios and you struggle with this. Here's my challenge to you. Well, if fear and anxiety is your temptation, that's your weakness, strengthen it through what? Faith. Read books on faith. Learn about worry and anxiety. Learn about mental disciplines. Grow your relationship with God. Why? Because the stronger your faith is, the weaker your fear will be. Strengthen your weakness. Maybe your struggle isn't fear and anxiety. Maybe it's anger. Maybe it's saying the wrong things. And you're constantly have to apologize because you're snapping at your kids, snapping at your wife, snapping at your employees, and you're just frustrated. Well, let me tell you something. Most people that snap, it stems from one of two things. The first is this. You're too busy. and you're not getting enough rest. In other words, you notice that when you're late to somewhere and you got to run, and you're going, and it doesn't work out, what do? You have a tendency to snap more. You have a tendency to struggle. Or the second reason is this. You've got unforgiveness. Somebody's hurt you. Somebody's wounded you, and you haven't let go of it. Let me tell you something. Jesus, you want to control the mouth, you change the heart. So what is your area of weakness? Find ways to forgive. Read books on it. Find ways to balance your schedule so you live at more rest and peace, and you'll find yourself, once again, strengthening your weakness and failing less. What if it's finances? I think we talked about this earlier. 70-something percent of people live paycheck to paycheck. One of the greatest stresses in marriage is financial issues. So here's my challenge. Strengthen it. Take FPU. Like, if you realize it's such a problem and such a stress area of your life, then why not discover disciplines, learn how to save, learn how to budget, learn how to have healthy conversations? The average person within a year saves over like $5,000 off their debt, right? Saves over $1,000 in emergency fund, does all of these great things. In other words, it's an incredible thing. So here's my challenge. If this is your weakness, May 7th, we launch it here at this campus. Go ahead and sign up for it. Why not strengthen your weakness? And for those of you, I want to talk to you, for those of you married, just for a moment. Those of you that are married, we know that marriages are one of the greatest temptation struggles, that over 50% of them end in divorce. And I'm not here to judge you if you're in a divorce. Please don't hear me. In fact, you might even agree exactly with what I'm saying after I say this. But what I'm saying is, if we know and understand that marriage is going to be a struggle, and it is, if half the people will go, I will give up everything to be with this one person, and somewhere down the line go, I'll give up half of everything to leave this person, there is problems when it comes to relationships. So what are some ways you could take what is often areas of weakness and strengthen them? Here's one of them. Listen to what the scripture says. Men, you might want to take this down and write this down. Do not deprive each other sexual relationships. I'm watching men take pens out all over. This is amazing. You guys are reading the Bible. So don't deprive each other of sexual relations, right? Unless you both agree to refrain from sexual intimacy, what? For a limited time. So that you can give yourselves, here's the reason, right? Not more to your kids, not more to work, not more to sports center or the house or chores, right? But more completely to prayer. So evidently a lot of you are married to prayer warriors and your marriage is great. I'm glad to see that, right? Now, but I want you to see the end of this because this is where I want you to see, right? But afterwards, okay? Like afterwards you've taken the time and you've prayed and you sought God. Here's what I want you to do. You should come back together again, be intimate again. So that, here's the reason, I want you to see this, so that Satan won't be able to tempt you because of your lack of self-control. And I want you to see this, in all seriousness, I know this, joking aside, I want you to see this. When in your marital relationship, God built there to be sexual intimacy, and whatever gets in the way, maybe you're not being nice, maybe the kids are just sucking the life out of you, which is probably it, right? Maybe it's too busy, it's work, it's stress, it's your mind, your depression, anxiety, whatever it is, doesn't matter what it is. When two people that are married are lacking sexual intimacy, two things happen, right? Here's what happens. Your temptation increases. Your desire for that actually increases because you were created by God to fulfill those desires with the marriage. And your self-control decreases. Listen. That's not a good combination, is it? That's not a good environment to put ourselves in when it comes to our marriages and our lives. And Paul says, I want you to understand something. Listen, I know there's more to marriage than just sexual intimacy, but listen, that's part of it. And I want you to realize this. When there is lack for whatever reason inside of your marriage, what you are doing is you're increasing temptation and you're decreasing your self-control. And so you need to make sure that this is part of your life is very fulfilling, that you schedule, do whatever it takes, because what's going to happen is there's going to be failure after failure because of this one area. Now listen, this is not an excuse to do it. This is not an excuse to go, well, see, look, that's why I had the affair. No. What you're doing is still wrong. What I'm saying is simply this. God who loves you goes, hey, listen, I don't want to see you fail. So you need to make sure this is an area of your life that is good, that is healthy, that is right. Listen, maybe in your marriage it's not just sexual intimacy. For some of you, it might be emotional intimacy. And what I mean by this is that you used to date and laugh and have fun and used to have conversations and talk about life, but now maybe he's too busy all the time and he's too busy at Sports Center. He's too tired, exhausted from work, right? And so every time you want to talk, he's not even really paying attention to what you say. Well, you know what? The guy at work might be listening. The person on Facebook might be willing to hear. And what is happening? The same thing is happening. When we deny people that are certain needs that God created in our lives, the temptation increases, the self-control decreases. So in the same way, with emotional intimacy, physical intimacy, here's what I'm saying to you. You need to strengthen this weakness. To don't leave your marriage or relationship in this vulnerable state, because the enemy knows what your weakness is, and he's going to go after it. This is why my wife and I, listen, I want to be clear. My wife and I work really hard at this, and I'm proud of her for this. We work really hard at this. We literally have a calendar that we keep that tracks everything. We track every date night. There it was. Last Thursday night, we went to City Place. We had dinner. We sat outside. We watched a movie together. We had a date night. Wednesday morning, we sat together. That's our morning to have emotional intimacy, right? Date night once a week, emotional intimacy. Wednesday morning, 8 a.m., we sat down. We prayed together. We talked about God. We talked about what's going on in our lives and our work week, and we just know kids. We just have this conversation, right? We track physical intimacy and everything. Here's why. I want to make sure that our marriage is strong. I don't want to fail. I don't want her to fail. I want to be fulfilled. I want to strengthen the weakness, because I don't want to be one of those people who's a good person that does a bad thing because I'm overconfident that she would never and I would never. I want to close with this. Listen to what the scripture says. Next slide. Go and put this slide up. Or not. The computer freezes sometime. Here's what I want us to see. There we go. Because I want to close with this. Listen to what we're taught about temptation. God is faithful for those of you that are struggling. And he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. I love that. There's never an excuse to do the wrong thing. But when you are tempted, he will provide you a way out so that you can stand up under it. But here's what we miss in this. Sometimes the way out isn't in that moment. Sometimes that way out is locking doors beforehand. It's creating predetermined boundaries beforehand. It's strengthening the weaknesses beforehand. And my challenge and my hope for everyone in this room is the same. Man, if Peter can fail, so can you. Don't be overconfident that my husband would never, my wife would never, my kid would never. Don't be foolish and think you are so strong you can never be weak. Lock the doors you can lock. Predetermine your boundaries and strengthen your weakness, and leverage wisdom. Help each other overcome the battles of temptation, because many times the key to victory is not just trust or faith or strength or self-control. It's using wisdom to fight your battles, and wisdom is not weakness. All of us need this. And so I challenge you, have some uncomfortable conversations with those you love. Predetermine your boundaries, lock the doors that you can lock, and strengthen your weakness. And together, let's win these battles. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your wisdom. God, I know just like you, just like you tried to warn Peter, you want all of us to live a life free of regrets. You have so much you want to do in us. Help us use discernment, use wisdom, create boundaries, and live in victory and live a life without regret. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Right, Journey, right before we get up, start moving around, listen, this message series is incredible, and there is no doubt that the enemy would want nothing more than to come in and mess with your mind and give you all kind of this condemnation, right? And when God's just trying to convict our heart so that we have some internal changes, right? So if there is anything that is in your mind right now and you're just like, man, I can't do this, this isn't gonna happen, I just want you to completely remove that stuff and allow God to work on your heart. And before you leave this place, I would love for you to just get some prayer. Our prayer team's down front. They would love to pray with you, stand in the gap with you as you create some of these things, that these safeguards to protect your marriage, your family, your life, to be who God has created you to be. And listen, I'm excited about it. There's a good chance that you know somebody that might need this series really could kind of glean from it. You might know that person. I want you to invite them back with you. Bring them with you next week. Make sure that they're sitting next to you so that they can continue to be a part of this series. And as I said earlier today, listen, we have Financial Peace University table out in the lobby to the left. We have our Mexico table out to the right. Our team are at both of those tables. They would love to talk to you before you leave here. And no matter if you're going to work this week, if you're going back to your neighborhood, if you're going to high school, you're going to college, whatever it is, listen, go back. We will not conform, but we will be transformed. Have a great week, guys.